Good morning, kids. Today we're checking out a brand new video from Dead Meat, Critters 4 Killcount from 1992. Let's check it out.
Previously on the Critters Killcounts.
James?
Affirmative. I needed to show up to make sure that people keep watching these Critters Killcounts.
Yeah, but what are you going to do to keep the views up?
I'm watching them.
Give the people what they want. Which is why I've sent another host to take over for the next kill count.
Whoa, what? Who?
Another host?
Inside
who?
This pod.
What pod?
I can't believe we got a new host. Are you kidding me? Come on, I'm this channel's fun uncle that lets them drink beer.
I'm not.
All right, let's see who's in here.
It's
oh,
a
hi, Molly. Oh, god damn it.
Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm Molly A. Dog, and today we're talking...
Sorry, this is...
Wait, the dog is meant to be the host? Nah, that ain't serious. That's adorable and cute, but that ain't serious.
Just too silly, even for a Zoran Kill Count. Alright, go on. Yeah, go on and get! Alright, newest editor Sarah, roll that intro again.
You got it.
Click. Sweet.
Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm Zoran, double spaces after a sentence Gavoyich, and today we continue
that?
Raphael's least favorite franchise with Critters 4, released direct-to-video in 1992.
Where did they come up with
this stuff? As we all know, a good horror franchise eventually winds up in space. But
yeah,
actually, this one technically started in space, so it makes more sense. Critters 4 picks up where the last one left off,
okay.
With Charlie told by Ugg to preserve the last Krite eggs in the universe. Unfortunately, the poor guy gets sent into space with them, frozen and flung into the future like Cartman waiting for a Nintendo Wii. He teams up with a crew of space salvagers to endlessly wander the halls of a space station, occasionally stumbling upon critters when the budget allows. Contrary to its name, Critters 4 barely has four critters in it.
You know, I kind of call Critters 4 Critters Light.
This was due to last-minute script changes after writer...
Wait, so it doesn't even have four critters? What, does it only have two, three, one? Nah, we saw two eggs, so it would probably just have the two.
David J. Scow was brought in to fix the original script by Joseph Lyle.
Well, we have this many dollars left in the screenplay fund. Can you save Critters 4 for us? I said, this is what I offered to do originally.
With the script changes, it became impossible to afford more Krites.
Had they told us, we might have been able to accommodate it.
We spent all the money to build the puppets on Critters 3. All the money was done and spent and things were built.
Critters 4 was filmed back-to-back with Critters 3, so a lot of the remained as they tore down the apartment sets and built an entire spaceship inside the abandoned grocery store they had rented. And kudos to production designer Philip Dean Foreman for making all of this with basically no money. In a grocery store. Taking up directing duties was Rupert Harvey, who had co-produced the previous films alongside Barry Opper. Harvey's more British sensibilities nixed a lot of the lighthearted tone of the previous films. So sadly, there are no critter parties.
Critters 4 is much darker than any of the other three movies.
For that and many other reasons, Critters 4 is my least favorite of the original films. While it's not an insult to humanity like Critters A New Binge, it's just really boring. With most of the
I'm sorry, what the hell was that?
Film being people clacking on keyboards and spouting generic sci-fi jargon.
ID transmit incoming.
I must go downstairs and make sure that the gravity panels still drag in a ton and a half, okay?
I got the de-icer boots working, sir.
Must be one of them subsection power lines shorting out in the condensation.
Oh my god, there is so much of that. And worst of all, the critters spend most of their time hiding in vents and behind off-screen POV shots. But thankfully, when they do show up, they still look great thanks to the Kyoto brothers. Can the longest film in the franchise with the fewest critters actually increase our numbers?
Not bloody likely.
Well, let's make sure and get to the kills.
Well, let's dig in.
The movie begins right where the last one left off. Charlie's trying to destroy some critter eggs, only for Daddy Ugg to tell him, nope! To show how serious this is, Ugg sends a space capsule to destroy this building. Since these are the last remaining Krite eggs in the universe, Charlie has to put them in this pod that's conveniently designed.
Why not execute the Krites? I mean, if they're meant to be a terror among the universe, why not execute? I mean, I can understand if it's meant to be a whole... Oop, hold on, folks. Be right back. And we're back. Let's move on.
mined for exactly 2 critter eggs. The pod then gives a 15-second warning to escape, which it promptly ignores and immediately locks Charlie in before knocking him out with a fog machine. The Tylenol pill of a pod is then rapidly released into space.
Damn.
It flies off into the horizon and directly into a
catapult.
Oh man, that low-budget explosion really setting our expectations here. We flash forward 53 years to the Saturn quadrant, where not Leonardo DiCaprio is juggling some planets. He then takes a moment to completely contradict the year we just saw by showing this is 2342 instead of 2045. Oh, you know, just a minor difference of 300 years. That's older than America. This is Ethan, an engineer apprentice on the RSS Tesla. The rest of the crew includes lecherous Captain Rick Buttram, the endlessly gum-chewing and confoundingly named engineer Al Albert Burt, the overly qualified pilot Fran, and Rob Van Bland over here is cargo specialist Bernie. Ethan can't wait to get home so he can see his dad again. The rest of the crew can't wait to get this movie started by taking Charlie's red pill of a ship with some literal shaky effects work. They pull the pod aboard and Ethan spots an old intergalactic council logo.
Before they dissolve?
Yeah, the old logo.
So wait, did they dissolve or just get a new logo? Eyes confused. Dissolved or not, the crew reports their findings to this very Weyland-Yutani-like TerraCore, which just so happens to be run by Ugg!
I am Council.
Hey!
Oh, God damn it! Movie, will you get your continuity right for like 5 seconds? Oh wait, Tetra? Now that logo makes sense. Tetra, is prepared to offer them 3 times the going rate for the pod, if they can make it to his station 3 days away. Actually, shouldn't that be 4 times in 4 days? That's a true Tetra.
Nerd!
The crew briefly argues about holding out for more money. And if I had a nickel for every time they argued on the Tesla, I'd have 1 fake unit of currency. They agree to Tetra's terms and conclude this Disney Rideline video that really just makes me miss the alien encounter ride they had at Tomorrowland. God, that was scary as hell. Much better than Stitch's crappy licking escape or whatever the hell that thing was. Some decent spaceship model shots eventually take us to the TerraCore base, where we meet the station's motherly AI.
You may call me Angela.
Ooh, that's a little awkward. We've already got an Angela on board. Yeah, that's right. Angela Bassett.
Committed, cool. Had an intensity, very present. Who she is today, man. Great actor.
In fact, let's take a moment to talk about the incredible cast who elevates this material much higher than it deserves. We, of course, have Academy Award nominee Angela Bassett, who was recently the epitome of Yas Queen in Wakanda Forever. The scummy captain is played by Danish actor Anders Hove, most famous for the Subspecies films. And then there's this guy.
Why does that look so familiar?
Well, it's probably because he's Oscar nominee Brad Dourif, previously seen on the kill count in the endlessly blocked Chucky recaps, and also several other films. And don't forget Bernie, he was the drug dealer in Twin Peaks. Oh, and as for Ethan, I don't know, he's just some guy. An extended conversation with the ship's computer plays out like me talking to
He's just some guy who will eventually be known as Jack and then will die in a freezing sea after giving a blue gem to the woman he loved.
My Alexa.
The computer's fucked up.
I beg your pardon.
It lets us know the station is abandoned, so time for Bert to get busy with his magic fingers.
Brad came up with that whole bit that he would do sitting in his station. He would rattle off a bunch of keys and finalize it by just going bap like that.
He sees that most of the floors are shut down to conserve power, but on their level they have executive suites and a pharmacy that piques Bernie's interest.
Me where the pharmacy is.
Feeling a little bit under the weather there, Bernie?
No, he's just finally trying to give us that Medicare for All plan his campaign promised. The computer's logic is about 50%, allowing for some nice comedic moments.
Take me to the visiting ship dock.
What?
Ship's doctors will be found on deck 4. Corridors 11.
Cancel!
Oh, it's so nice to finally see an AI that's as accurate as Siri.
Zorin, I found 2 Acura dealerships near you. Would you like me to book a test drive?
Fuck off!
Wait, no. Book a maintenance appointment, I need one!
They also learned the station's nuclear core is at yellow alert, but that doesn't pose any immediate danger, so they don't have to worry about that till Act 3.
That was a little
Everyone
loud.
Splits up to explore the station.
Tell me which way to the wet showers.
Oh, sorry, no wet showers in the future. We all just take dust baths like chinchillas. never mind, there is still one working wet shower.
Oh,
and as
cool.
Stella's got her boobs to the back of the camera, Captain Jack Pervo watches before joining her.
Come in.
Oh God, really? She's gonna... Yes,
Bojack
him in the face. Damn, I love you, Angela.
Why, that's very kind.
Not you. Wrong rest Angela. Of the crew witnesses the captain going down with her fist and makes jokes about him after he runs off.
Asshole.
Captain asshole.
Ah.
Our eye lines make no sense. The captain takes his anger out on the pod. The weapon sets off an alert, and we learn the best way to deal with Angela's broken logic circuits is reverse psychology.
Do not give me security clearance to all levels.
You have security clearance in all levels.
Ethan is sent down to investigate, but gets trapped in the elevator, which allows the captain to redo his thing, thus opening up the coffin pod. Yes, time for some critters! But actually, no. Instead, we get an extended scene of the captain giving Ethan life advice.
You're young.
Oh, come on. We don't need to see this.
Lots of chances. There'll come a time when those chances run out.
You are actually going to have critters in your critters movie here, perhaps. The conversation goes south when Ethan refuses to help the captain steal the pod. He's then subsequently knocked out and strung up like a Hans Gruber henchman. A noise from the pod makes the captain abandon his Leatherfacean playtime, and upon investigation, he finds Charlie, who thinks no time has passed at all.
I almost got lost. Oh. I'm in space, aren't I?
Honestly, I love how disappointed he is to be in space again.
That is actually a little funny. It's like, man, I almost got locked inside that son of a bitch. I'm in space again, aren't I? Well, great. Just great.
Also, Don Opper really does a great job making Charlie a likable fella. This fella, on the other hand, is a piece of shit. And this piece of shit's looking to eat something for breakfast. But turns out these eggs have already hatched. Or maybe
crap.
Charlie found that Playboy from part two. Oh, come on, man, use a sock. The critter babies attack the captain, crunching on him and launching directly into his mouth. And everyone knows that a critter in your craw will make you scream like an elephant. He rides around looking like Greta from Nightmare 5. All while Charlie breaks his personal pinto-powered pea shooter. Until finally, the captain dies with an inanimate critter puppet shoved down his throat. With his pinto popper kaput, Charlie grabs the captain's gun and gives one of the critter babies a haircut, hearkening back to his ancestor from the Hungry Heifer.
Yeah!
They leave their meal behind, and Charlie frees Ethan to go wander the-
And that's how you create a puppet to then reuse a puppet. So very good job.
The corridors with him. Charlie explains he's a bounty hunter looking to exterminate the critters, which he tries to describe to Ethan.
You see Piranha?
Oh yeah, I've seen the original, the Aha remake, and the made-for-TV remake with Mila Kunis.
TV remake?
Like a piranha.
Damn, all those hours wasted. Especially on that last one. Ethan nabs a lab coat that has the right key to advance to the next level. And that level is this leftover specimen lab from Flight of the Navigator. They putz around for a bit until Charlie finds a vent. And before you can say, come out to the coast, a disposal tube is activated, sending them from Die Hard ripoff to Star Wars ripoff.
Damn
they land in the styrofoam and chicken feather storage room, where Angela starts the jettison sequence to remove this mainstay from the franchise.
Oh, that
but
ain't good.
They're able to escape through more reverse psychology and another vent that leads them back to Bernie.
About time.
The final frontier for all horror franchises.
Damn it.
Leprechaun, Pinhead, Jason, Turkey, even the fucking Amityville house for some reason.
What?
So the question is, who is left?
That's right, bitches. In space, no one can hear you dream.
Why was that the line I was
thinking?
Planet
Elm Street. One small step for man, one giant sleep for mankind.
Oh, what
a
load of
crap.
You know, not every horror franchise needs to go to... you gotta be fucking kidding me!
Chuck Rogers in the 24th and a half century!
Chuck Rogers? Oh, come on!
They hide the solar system.
The crew convenes in the AstroTurf playroom, where Ethan lets Charlie know that his license is very...
I know those were fake ads and all, but that is honestly funny. I would laugh even more at that.
Expired.
Charlie, this is like 53 years ago.
Okay, so it is 2045? Dude, you gotta fix your calendar. Also, that license is so old, it somehow has lost the S on Grover's Bend. Okay, I'm sorry, who was the script supervisor on this? Diane H. Newman? Oh, come on, you worked on WandaVision and Friends. Actually, that finally explains why Ross misspelled Rachel's last name on the wedding invite.
Ah.
I watch a lot of Friends, because I don't.
We could tell. We can tell.
Ethan uses the Mondrian computer to access some exposition from Dr. McCormick, the scientist whose ID he found. She's played by Anne Ramsey, right before landing her most notable role of Lisa Stemple on Mad About You. McCormick's been researching alien creatures to use as weapons. Seems familiar. And they've had good luck with the unfortunately named Syphiloids, who could STD-stroy an entire planet. But, you know, they can easily be stopped by penicillin. So she's on the lookout for a new breed of creature that can self-replicate and is very aggressive.
Yeah, I gotta do a tribute.
Shut up.
The fuck you will.
Oh yeah, it's an all-out gremlin critter fight!
A bit of a stretch. I getcha.
That's much lamer than I thought it would be. To save money, the critters have been watching all of this from the vent. They then see Bernie made off with Sarah Logan's key, and he uses it to open the door to the pharmacy, revealing a Shangri-Lot of pills. All stored without any labels. He grabs them like a kid in an opioid store, but a bioscan reveals the critters are on their way. Seems familiar. Oh, god damn it, it bit me. Bert tries to warn B. Ernie like a stuttering gas station worker, but the ponytailed plunderer won't possibly be placated without his precious package of pick-me-up pills!
A lot of peas.
Zorn, did you over-alliterate, buddy?
I'm good. The perp's prolonged pill pursuing.
Oh, yes, I'm good.
I'm okay. Gives the critters plenty of time to ambush him from outside and inside somehow.
What?
God, these things teleport faster than a Hayden Christensen movie to a Walmart bargain bin. Their attack causes more stumbling and flailing with stuffed animals. And judging from these behind-the-scenes photos, actor Eric Dare was not a fan of filming this scene.
No, he was not.
In the next branch.
Hold on, folks. We'll be right back. And we're back.
So the crew arrives too late to save Bernie, and they find him dead on the floor. Man, talk about a weak end to Bernie. The critters use the kill count graphic as a distraction
to
plot a new course for Earth. You know, to get this franchise back on track.
I'll pack the ship, you get the kids.
Unfortunately, the kids aren't all right. After
hold on, folks, I'll be right back. And we're back.
Regala rebels against this tribe of eggs. She smashes most of them before Bert busts out his Chucky yell. I'm sorry, why would you stop her from... whatever, it doesn't matter. They make it back to the ship and prepare to launch while the Gemini Killer upgrades Charlie's method of murder.
Antique Colt 45 used to be the most powerful handgun on Earth.
Hey, we got another gun nut named Bert. Charlie puts the gun to use when a critter pops out of this movie's favorite location, a vent. It runs around the cockpit while Charlie fires and misses. And he finally lands a shot that kills our first critter an hour and 8 minutes into this thing. Too bad it's not the only thing that Charlie killed.
Congratulations, Charlie. You have just murdered the ship.
But we don't count ships unless they're sentient. And this one ain't no Moya. With their only ship deactivated, the pissed off crew shames Charlie and sits back to wait for Terracor to come and rescue them. Ethan then steals Bert's gun to go take care of the last critter. Bert tries to stop him, but you know, Chucky's never been the best with kids.
You're not my father!
But if he was, he'd accept you for who you are.
No matter what!
With his serenity lost, the space cowboy searches the halls to this bizarre, almost Tremors-like music that's been playing throughout the movie. Ethan's hunt for the Krites proves to be a very possible mission, as he finds more hatched eggs and a very gooey, hairless critter baby in an incubator.
Ew.
We couldn't ooze them up enough. And I remember the Kyotos, we were having such fun.
The critters use a metabolic accelerator to help this baby balloon past porcupine puberty and straight into critdulthood. Ethan then just kinda looks at this and then runs away.
Hell, even
the critter could give two shits at this point. Meanwhile, Terracor has arrived, borrowing some footage of the bounty hunter ship from the first two movies. A couple of Darth Vader paintballers emerge alongside Ugg, or Tetra, Brother Dusk. Who is this guy again?
He was my friend. He is.
Actually, he might be a Jurassic Park 3 Velociraptor, since the only thing he wants right now is eggs. Tetra tries forcing Fran to tell him where they are with a game of slap shots.
Damn.
Ooh, shots.
Woo.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Best slap hurricane shot. Party ever. Come to me.
I don't like this party anymore.
Bert's worm tongue insults this go-go 80s Reaganaut. He pulls out a gun and shoots Bert in the Ade Due Dembele, turning him into a dead would-be hero. An upset Ethan has an appropriate reaction to his father figure's death. Well, Charlie responds in a much more laid-back way.
Look. What?
I'm sorry, someone you know just died in front of you. That's not how you react.
Zorn, my dearest friend, you said you wanted me in for a cameo?
Oh, damn! Just shot him in the belly.
That's how you react to your friend just dying. All right, bit's over, Michael.
Get it. Shovel.
Trek tells the Masters of the Universe guards to search the station, while this movie searches for an explanation as to why Ugg is set to evil.
I did not make Ugg evil. Rupert and Barry made Ugg evil.
I remember where the ideas came from, but I don't know that they were necessarily good ideas. We were looking for a twist.
M. Night Shyamalan, you are not.
No, you are not.
Honestly, he's not even that great at it. We get a boring game of hallway no cat comment. And mouse as Ethan shows Angela who's the boss. Using more reverse psychology, he gets her to funnel the foreign market stormtroopers into the lab. Once they're trapped inside, a whole lot of whip pans hide the low number of puppets they had on hand.
Yeah.
On hand, you get it?
Yes.
What do you know? Also, what is this number measuring? Is it meters? Because they're not that far.
I don't know.
Maybe it's just minutes till we can finally end this movie. Anyway, their aim is somehow worse than actual stormtroopers, which leads to some off-screen screams signifying these were the deaths we were looking for.
They grab
some eggs that they really should have let Fran smash earlier. But if they did that, what would he be able to juggle now in order to distract Ugg-I-Am? Please don't smash my green eggs on the door, and do not smash them on the floor. Ethan positions himself so Fran can grab the gun tucked in his non-bounty hunter leaves. Then he tosses the last egg in the air. And when Ugg goes for it, Fran uses the gun to punch him. Whatever. I guess she only likes gunpowder in her milkshakes. Fran's been waiting to exit. And with Ugg-tra knocked out, she finally heads to the ship with Charlie. But Ethan stays back to make sure that Charles Lee laying there doesn't pass his soul into any dolls. And that's when a very alive critter pops out of, another vent. This bald critter charges him, because I guess they never went to Quill Shooting Academy in this movie?
Yeah.
But hey, we do get a cool rolling ball cam that they were able to achieve with...
pipe with a wheel on it, and we mounted a critter ball on it that would spin, which was really quite cool, I thought.
Ethan's able to grab a, cooling spaceship stick, allowing the critter to vape for a bit, delivering toxic metals like nickel and lead into its lungs. That's metal in your lungs. E-Sig finally freezes George Kristanza, and its death is more than confirmed when Ethan kicks it into a wall, smashing it like a Hot Shots Hussein.
Very nice.
All right, that's it.
Hold on, folks. We'll be right back. And we're back.
Unfortunately, Ugg-tra has woken back up and is ready to snipe Ethan in cold blood. Charlie comes to the rescue, pointing the Colt 45 at this cold, almost 45-year-old.
You can do it, Charlie. You never could.
Okay, so this is the same Ugg and not a clone or whatever. I guess he must have forgotten that Charlie did pull the trigger on the biggest bounty kill in the franchise.
Yeah,
so he pulls
the
trigger again now, shooting this solar baby in the head with the power to say goodnight.
Things change.
So do people.
Fran declares this space station has fallen, and they blast off in the TerraCore ship. All while Angela's sweet, nutty nuclear core explodes with something more than flavor. And this standard sci-fi ending explosion is going to add 6 more critters to the bounty board that we can see in these confusing whip pans in the lab. There's one on his own, 3 over here, this one, and I think a reused bleachy in the background. The movie ends with Charlie being told not to touch anything, even though he's actually flown this exact type of ship before. But still, he can't help himself when he sees a big red button. The kind that should never ever be pushed. It then launches us into more reused footage and a royalty-free version of Great Balls of Fire. How many people's screams went unheard thanks to these spaced invaders? Let's find out and get to the numbers, with the help of this new computer AI that I installed in the Dead Meat set. Hey Angela, initiate to the numbers bit for Critters 4.
Did you say burn down James and Chelsea's house?
Wait, what? No! No! Oh my god!
This is why I don't let you do more kill counts. I know.
Oh my god.
Hope my wife and pets are okay.
Oh shit.
Well, 3 people and 4 aliens died in Critters 4. 4 men, that is if you count Ugg as identifying as male, and 3 unknown, giving us another frozen critter of a pie chart. With a runtime of 105 minutes, that gives us a kill on average every 15 minutes. As for the bounty board, we can add 8 critters, One for Ethan, one for Charlie, and six for Angela. That gives us a critter kill on average every 13.1 minutes.
Not too big of a difference.
Seems way too high for this movie. I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Captain Rick Buttram. The effects were a little limited, but hey, we've never seen a baby critter choke a bitch like Wayne Brady.
The Eddie for Lang's kill goes
to the three snowboard troopers, because, you know, the costumes look dumb, their aim was dumb, their off-screen deaths were dumb. Just everything about this was painfully
dumb.
I mean, seriously, I think that's just tinfoil on their helmets. And the Bounty Booty Award for best critter kill goes to Baldi. Sure, it may be derivative of Terminator 2, which, you know, came out that same year, but still it's a unique kill that isn't just shooting or blowing them up off-screen.
Ain't nothing wrong with the freeze.
Critters 4 came out in 1992 and has some incredible actors working with a script and budget that were less so.
Subpar.
The next Critters film wouldn't come out for 27 years and would ditch basically all connections to the previous entries. I'll look at that one next week to finish off our Critathlon, but until then, I'm a man whose kill counts have more cameos than a Muppet movie, and this has been one of those kill counts. Yay, I'm not alone in the end!
Alright folks, that's going to be the end of today's video. I hope you all enjoyed it. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe for more. Link will be in the description below. And I'll see all of you folks next time when we flick on. Peace out.